Tonight, I'm pleased to introduce Eva Díaz on the occasion of the exhibition Josef Albers in Mexico. This show examines Albers's many trips to Mexico, over a dozen in all from the 1930s to the 1960s, and the way in which those trips informed his work as an abstract painter and photographer. With his wife, Annie Albers, whose own work was inspired in different yet equally profound ways, Josef made extensive studies of the ancient ruins of Mexico. The show highlights Albers's legacy as an artist, but understanding the impact he had on 20th century culture also requires an examination of his legacy as a theorist and a teacher. As a Bauhaus master, a faculty member at Black Mountain College, and a professor at Yale, Albers taught at some of the most important institutions for the development of 20th century art. And in those positions, he influenced some of the most consequential artists of the 20th century. Albers's experiences in Mexico informed his teaching philosophy. One of the few occasions during which he presented his photographs publicly was at a lecture for his students. And the pre-Columbian objects he and Annie collected were also used as instructive tools. So a full understanding of Albers's body of work requires a nuanced perspective on how his teaching fit together with his art making. And for that reason, I'm very excited to welcome Eva Díaz here tonight, whose scholarship has advanced our understanding of Albers's teaching methods. Her 2015 book, The Experimenters, Chance in Design at Black Mountain College, which was published by the University of Chicago Press, examines the period in the late 1940s and 1950s when Albers, John Cage, and Buckminster Fuller pioneered new techniques in art instruction at Black Mountain College. Díaz is an associate professor of art and design at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, and her writing has appeared in many magazines and journals from the Art Bulletin, Art in America, Grey Room, October, and many others. She was recently awarded a grant from the Graham Foundation to complete her new book entitled After Spaceship Earth, which analyzes the influence of Buckminster Fuller in contemporary art. And this project is also supported by a Warhol Foundation grant and a Creative Capital Art Writers grant. Tonight, we welcome Eva Díaz as she shares her insights on how Albers' legacy continues to influence and inspire artists and viewers in the 21st century. Please join me in welcoming her.
So thank you, Lauren, for that introduction, for having me, and thank you all for coming. And I have to admit, I've been really in this world of the legacy of Buckminster Fuller, literally in outer space, in terms of the writing I've been doing about legacies of Fuller, and it's a nice opportunity today to think about legacies of Albers in contemporary art. And there are many different threads that we could think about in looking at his work, but I want to really concentrate on the way in which the kind of procedures of testing in his pedagogy become really important, not just in terms of thinking about how things that we would call geometric abstraction sort of look or seem to continue the visual or sort of morphological similarities between Albers's work or with Albers's work and contemporary geometric abstraction practices, but to think about, again, this kind of idea of a process of learning how to see the world differently that was part of the battery of tests that he began to develop as the Vor course at the Bauhaus in the 1920s, as when he was the instructor for the preliminary course, and then on to his time at Black Mountain College. And I want to carry that thread of thinking about these procedures of testing and variation to talk about the work of Jill Magid, a contemporary artist that did her own kind of learning through Albers by essentially producing copies of his work based on instructions that are on the back of every Josef Albers painting. So the second half of the talk, we'll look at this kind of legacy using Jill's work as a case study to think about what it means to copy someone whose work was already sort of full of repetition. So just to kind of back up and think about what is this method of procedures of testing in Albers's work, to give you the background of what their encounter in the Americas was like. and to kind of trace this thread of their both coming to America as emigres and then their trips to Mexico, which began in the mid-1930s and continued through the 1950s. So this is an image that I often sort of return in my mind to kind of think of this fresh off the boat moment of the Alberses arriving from Germany as exiles to this place that was very remote given the cosmopolitan nature of the Bauhaus in its last years in Berlin, and rural North Carolina, where Black Mountain College was founded in 1933, would not seem to be the most hospitable location for two teaching masters from the Bauhaus. But it, you know, with the curriculum that Josef Albers instituted in terms of an art program and that Annie Albers creating a weaving workshop at Black Mountain really became the formative model of Black Mountain College's vision of experimental procedures in creating, in allowing students to sort of learn by doing. And when I use that phrase, it should already sort of echo to us an interesting cross-pollination of ideas happening from America to Europe, in the sense that the Black Mountain College was founded with a great interest in John Dewey's, the philosopher John Dewey's work in terms of progressive pedagogy as a process of learning by doing. So the Bauhaus actually in its founding materials faculty were reading John Dewey and creating their own program in Europe based on this American innovations around progressive pedagogy. And you have to remember that, you know, in German education there was a great deal of regimentation and hierarchy. And so this freedom that John Dewey's work presented to the nascent Bauhaus curriculum was really important. So what Albers does when he comes to Black Mountain is sort of rework what was already a very important idea for the founding of Black Mountain College in 1933. And I'm just showing you here the first, on the left-hand side is the first campus of Black Mountain College, Robert E. Lee Hall. And in Black Mountain, which is about 10 miles east of Asheville, just to kind of situate you in this Buncombe County, North Carolina. And the college then bought land nearby on a campus appropriately called Lake Eden, which was a former summer camp. And the area was known for summer camps. In fact, Black Mountain College, when it folded in 1957, was bought by a Christian summer camp. Camp Rockmont for Boys still exists at the physical plant of Black Mountain. You can see here that on that second campus, the faculty and students built it by hand based on a design of Lawrence Kocher's. And the Alberses were really instrumental in creating a program at the college that integrated like work, you know, here you can see the Black Mountain College work camp, to really have this learning by doing be effectuated through the actual labor of sustaining the community. And faculty and students, you know, found themselves often with very blurred lines between the traditional hierarchies of student and teacher. So what was the Albers curriculum? It was divided into three parts that he reworked slightly from his time at the Bauhaus. The first part was the drawing program, and what he encouraged in terms of drawing was not to study from life, which was the historic program of most Beaux-Arts education, was to study from the figure and to render and to really sort of duplicate what was in front of you as slavishly as possible. And for Albers, he felt that this was discouraging to creativity, because we all know, I mean, I know that I suck at rendering, right? And it made me, as a young student in art classes, feel very, very ashamed in a way that I couldn't draw very well. And I think for many of us, it curtails our sense of being able to explore what we call, you know, creativity and visual culture and visual production, because we can't do that. And for him, he wanted to step back from that requirement that we all just, you know, reproduce the figure from nature or still lives, and to think about the dynamics behind the sort of putting pen or pencil to paper. For example, he would encourage students to do what he called mirror writing, which is to write your name backwards or write your name with your non-dominant hand. So to get out of those habits of the facility that some have or the inelegance that some have in terms of using the pen or the pencil to transcribe the world in two dimensions. And so this, here you can see this kind of like unfolding of scrolls as a way to think dimensionality that still, it still, you know, has a sort of real world component. He's trying to get students to say, how does a page unfold, you know, if you were to think of it dimensionally, how do we translate that experience of three dimensions into two dimensions, which is essentially what drawing is. He also encouraged anamorphies in his exercises to think different perspectives in terms of, you can see here the typographic exercise, these anamorphic axiometric views of forms, to really think, and this is the really the key word of the Albers curriculum, is to think dynamically about form and to kind of slough the crust of habit off, that so frequently we just end up reproducing the world as we think we know it, as opposed to having a creative articulation of the world that comes from actually thinking about what we want to, you know, transcribe or produce as artists, thinking about it more carefully. And so this, in Albers's work, really comes down to the sort of problem for art production, which is that often we think of creativity as something that is sort of locked in the world of mere form. Like it's just sort of like, you know, being able to render nature or being able to just manipulate materials. But for him, everything in the world has form, and all of this form has meaning. And it has meanings that end up accruing sort of histories and reproduce themselves. And if we just so casually accept those meanings of form without being able to understand what it is that we're doing as artists, if we are artists, or what we're doing as viewers of form, then we just, again, end up reproducing the world as opposed to creating a world that is something that would be creative. And so for him, it was really important to disconnect the way in which what he called his art perceptual art, to disconnect the facility of apperception, meaning like we see so much of the world without even like, we have to close our eyes to stop seeing, right? It's just all there to us. It sort of appears to us. And so apperception is just this kind of process of the world coming to us. And cognition, on the other hand, is the way we think about the world without seeing it, right? You can close your eyes and cogitate, and you can imagine images and bring them to mind, but you don't have to have a visual referent there in front of you. Your retinal perception doesn't have to be working. And what he wanted to do was to connect those, but also to sort of revolutionize them both, so that perceptual art was this zone in which you would be able to translate these kind of apperceptive experiences, these retinal experiences, into possibly changed cognitive associations. So for example, I'll go back to this image, but just to think about color, which becomes the important part of his curriculum at Black Mountain College, is that very frequently, sorry, I'm kind of tied to this lectern, so I can't go over there. But here we have one of the studies that ended up in Interaction of Color, his 1963 color manual on the right-hand side. And what's happening here is that we're actually looking at that same kind of gray-brown tone, but because of the, you know, the way in which the colors around it have affected the perception, they appear to be different. So we are having a retinal experience of trying to reconcile that we know cognitively that that's the same color, but perceptually it's something different. It's deceiving us. And that zone of kind of working in dynamism and deception was really important to him, again, to sort of like get rid of this sort of problem of the world coming to us with habits that we reproduce. And so color becomes a really intense and important way that Albers is refocusing, so to speak, our attention to think about the dynamic qualities of form and to really say, okay, you know, maybe in a certain light, you know, I can say, well, that's a black jacket. But in a certain light, it might be more purple, or it might actually have a glare coming off of it from a light. And that what we would so quickly assign the cognitive meaning of blackness to that thing is actually perceptually something different. Because our retinal sort of, you know, coding just ends up saying like black, okay, and then we think about it, and then it's done. And that's not really a liberating perspective as an artist, if we're just sort of like assigning meanings and sort of repetitiously going through the world, you know, sort of like re-articulating what we already know. What he wanted was a creative re-articulation. And this for him was a definition of progressive pedagogy, which was that we're changing ourselves as in our vision, and that can be a socially transformative thing too. And so what we're doing is we're having sort of personal growth linked to social transformation, because we're able to stop reproducing these kinds of cognitive habits that, you know, end up sort of coding the world repetitively, and that we can ethically become better, have a better vision of the world if we stop doing that and start doing something else that's based on the material construction of objects and their appearance, really what they look like, not what we think or assign immediate meanings to. So in terms of the work with materials, that came about in the design courses that he taught at Black Mountain. And it was divided into two parts. And many of you who have, you know, have been art students have probably taken versions of the Bauhaus introductory course in your foundation courses, for example, which are exploring the properties of materials. And so the first part of the design course was what he called matière studies. And those were trying to kind of deceive surface appearance. So I know you can't read the small text here, but these are various studies by students at Black Mountain College in which on the top, the student is using leaves with screen to achieve the effect of shadows. Second, using eggshells and doilies to achieve the effect of flower petals. So trying to kind of use material to then create a surface that's different. So how do you make wood grain as a sort of trompe l'oeil condition of, like, you know, drawing on paper? So these kind of surface, whereas you know that paper doesn't have the tectonic strength of wood, but it's about manipulating surface appearance. And the second part of the design courses were based on actually the structure of forms and materials. So here you can see in the most basic sense what the capacity structurally of paper is very much changed when it's folded and created and becomes something dimensional as opposed to something flat. So these were procedures that he had initiated at the Bauhaus and then continued through his various years of teaching. And so just to kind of think about how this works in terms of Albers's own work, this was a piece. To be perfectly frank, when I first started working on Black Mountain College and knew that I was going to write a book about it, I felt in a sense that Albers was like an impediment to me to get through. He had this reputation of a kind of dogmatism or sort of rigidity of the teaching method. And the work was often, as I tried to sort of look through his oeuvre, it felt so impenetrable to me somehow, that it's like we have these very kind of minimal denotation, a lot of repetition, and really sort of wondering, like, what makes this work? Like, what's the work here? What separates it from the teaching? This is a concern not just that I sort of was troubled by, but even critics such as Donald Judd in the early 60s faulted Albers for being too much of a teacher and not enough of an artist. Clement Greenberg, also the infamous, formalist art critic, also levied a similar criticism on Albers that he was too dogmatic and represented a kind of logic art. And so a work like this, I sort of had to become a student of Albers's to even process what's going on in these kinds of very sort of minimal, this is a dry point etching from 1942 called Variants, and these kind of minimal works. And so, I sort of did the exercises in a sense. I tried mirror writing, I tried drawing things upside down. And then after working a bit through that, I just looked really hard at this work and a few others from this period when he was at Black Mountain and just tried to figure out what is going on in this. And I think, for me, there's a kind of deceptive simplicity, right? I mean, you're looking at these six form groups and upon first inspection, it feels like you're just looking at six of the same thing. But of course, as we tried to, I had a laser pointer here, but, oh, here it is. So I found this under the couch the other day. I was like, wow, a cat toy is back. So we have these six form groups that seem similar, these kind of egg, yolk, with these ellipses around them, this. And of course, here we have, if we look a little bit more carefully, we notice, well, they're not the same because this is a transposition. This last form group is actually flipped. But then even when we start looking at these more carefully, we realize, oh, well, there's different kinds of shading scenarios going on here. This part is both different than this, but not shaded. And so there's these decisions being made about the hatch marks that connote a kind of depth, but also seem to really snap us back to the surface of the image. And when there's no shading at all, you know, we sort of have to account for that, these different kind of like almost Venn-like overlaps of the condition of this, what this is, that exists here, 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 not here, but in the transposition there. So just, you know, sort of working through the subtlety of perception here is that, again, so often we sort of rush to judge what we see, and, you know, we know often that when we're looking at work, we're sort of overwhelmed with the amount of attention that art sort of demands of us. Like, we go to a museum and there's a lot to look at, and, you know, art is this kind of special attention that that says, okay, look at me with more, you know, with more verve than you would look at anything else, but we know that that kind of exhausts itself in a certain sort of, like, you know, what's going on. And so to really sort of, you know, at least Albers hoped, and I think every artist hopes that you look at their work carefully, but in Albers's case, I think what he tried to do was to really make it so that you sort of had this kind of pressure of, like, yes, you could easily snap this into the sort of sense of meaning, but to really unfold this idea of, like, everything having this sort of, every form having meaning, to really slow down your perception. And that's a definition of formalism very different than, let's say, Clement Greenberg's, that harkens back to, let's say, like, Russian formalists of the 19-teens that wanted to attenuate perception, to make vision slow and difficult so that it would allow us to account, again, for this process of perception moving between retinal, you know, sort of facts of the world out there that's, you know, dealing with our biology in here, and then that cognitive link. And so really for Albers, the kind of code of this, you know, attenuation was to create a sort of, you know, this, I guess, an attention to details that, you know, they're really about sort of variation and sort of allowing us to think, okay, well, this seems very subtle, but it's really the kind of constitutive mode of, again, of, like, how to produce the world, is that it comes, as an artist, through every, you know, every decision you make, every gesture. It's like, why shade one thing and not the other? To him, it was really, you know, this idea of a kind of dynamism of the composition, that the syncopation that we see here of something at the end, you know, sort of being different, you know, does sort of jolt us out of this, the familiarity even of these, like, six, you know, forms together. And so how this worked in terms of his sort of playing, and I almost think of it as a kind of, you know, sort of, yeah, like a sort of jolliness of, like, thinking about creation as something that has all these potentials. And if you imagine with Albers's career, there's no masterpiece, right? It's a continually process of producing, this is the variant series from the 1940s, of producing versions that take one and take the exploration in that and sort of push it in the next, using color and using the sort of design decisions of, in this case, with the variants, he created these templates that he would place over, and this is me sort of playing with them at the Albers Foundation, place them over a central arrangement to sort of weigh what created more of a sense of, let's say, ambiguities of depth. Is something flat? Is it three-dimensional? Ambiguities in terms of, as you can see with these different frames around the central windows, that, you know, in some cases, some of the gray, you know, sort of creates, like, more of a sense of sort of depth coming into focus. Other ones sort of snap into a more flat condition. And he worked through this. This is another. These are studies for the variants. You know, through a kind of very laborious kind of almost mathematics of trying to weigh, you know, what makes a composition more dynamic. Is it if the central part, the central windows are heavier in terms of color? Is it if they're larger with a lighter color? And so these issues of transparency and overlap also become really important in terms of how a work can, you know, can be sort of enlivened with its unpredictable composition. And so this, you know, many, the Albers Foundation is, and the show upstairs, you can see many of these colored tests that he would do to sort of weigh, you know, the decisions behind choosing one or another. And on the back of every one of Albers' paintings is what I call a sort of recipe that said exactly what he did to achieve this painting. It was used for his own reference to kind of push paintings, again, on this process of variation. He wouldn't mix colors, so he treated the tubes as ready-made, and he would then, you know, say, okay, I used these different yellow ochre from this paint manufacturer, you know, and then he would, you know, weigh when the completed painting, you know, was, you know, in front of him, he would sort of weigh, well, maybe I'll use a slightly different tone here, and that will create a different kind of effect in terms of, you know, again, this like sense of something receding or projecting or make you sort of look differently at a work that seems so similar. And so also in terms of the Albers work, there's a great deal of soft edge to what we would think of as hard edge abstraction. He never masked the edges of his works, and he, you know, would just sort of use a palette knife to create the edges. And so what you think of when you can see these is sort of like graphic construction seeming very constructed. And yet when you approach an Albers painting, and this is a detail, you can see that there's just a great deal of sort of variation going on even within, you know, this kind of hard edge. And these are two works that in various forms are upstairs. This is a study for Sanctuary, the work on the bottom, and then Tenyuka, both from 1942. And to think about, you know, this encounter that begins in the mid-1930s with the Alberses in Latin America, and what Albers was really drawing from this in terms of his own work, you know, this play of dimensionality is very important with the kind of sense of whether these are, when we're looking at some of these works that refer to architectures of the temples in Latin America, what are we looking at here? Are we looking at a sort of a plan architecturally, as though like an aerial, you know, plan, or are we looking at the elevation as though we're looking at something, you know, from the ground level? Are we looking at some kind of axiometric perspective in which there's like a vision coming from an unexpected quarter? And some have argued that with a work like Tenyuka, you're actually looking at design elements from the temples. This would be like a serpent figure that you can see elaborated more in the photography that Albers took upstairs. So there's this play of what is it that we're seeing, and how can we sort of assess the constant ambiguity of that in terms of it never being any of those things and all of them all at once. Also with the work on the bottom, Sanctuary, you know, you can see this sort of problem of perception in which your eye wants to sort of like put these different dark squares in some sort of, you know, in a sort of level of not having the visual tension that you see here, in which, you know, certain parts of them are sort of coming out at you, other ones are receding, and that dynamism of the composition really becomes a kind of visual tension in which your eye can't quite reconcile these different dimensional schemes of the work. So again, you know, the sense of Albers is like, you know, the dogmatic teacher. I love this image because it's like, you know, all of this freedom that I'm saying, you know, that this process like provides for students, and yet here we have the, like, you know, sort of automatons like following the master, you know, and there's footage of Albers teaching at Yale in which you see the same kind of exercise, you know, unfolding, that everybody's doing the same thing. So there's like a sort of, you know, Prussian sensibility here of, you know, following the leader. But I think, you know, just to kind of step back and again to unfold this as a proposition for students, you know, so many students have testimonials about the way in which this method allowed them to see the world differently. Even a student as advanced as Robert Rauschenberg felt himself to be when he was Albers' student in the 1940s at Black Mountain. He said, Albers, I felt, you know, it was so fundamental and elementary. And yet later, you know, what Rauschenberg says is that Albers' method taught him how to use materials, not just to, you know, assume when you're using a watercolor to use it the way it's always been used, but to really think about the material properties of watercolor, for example. And, you know, and Rauschenberg concludes in his sort of reflections on Albers that he was possibly Albers's poorest student for that reason of feeling himself, you know, better. So, and I just show you these two. I had invoked Donald Judd, who became an artist, but before he was an artist, he was an art critic, and he quite dismissively wrote of Albers's work from the early 1960s, saying a work like the Open Land here from 1963, you see on the left-hand side, you know, being sort of too pat in their use of color, too harmonic, actually, not dissonant enough. But it turns out Judd ended up buying this work and then sort of changed his mind when he put it at, in his office at Marfa. But what Judd returned to when he reflected on Albers some 30 years later was to say, you know, I misunderstood Albers, because what Albers, I thought that the pedagogy was too important in terms of Albers's own work. But what I failed to realize was that what's actually happening is that the pedagogy is good for his students. that's what it's for. It's actually for creating a process of having an advanced master work through exercises creatively in terms of this learning by doing laboratory experimentation, in which you take a very careful set of variables and test them and then make assessments and move on to a new study based on that. And that method is extremely generative because it allows you to participate in design whether you feel that you know, have a facility or that you're a trained artist or not. And I really like an image like this, and you'll see in the show a great deal of these photo collages that Albers did, in which you can see this sense of sequentiality and of a kind of serial practice, but one in which there's a sort of love of the instability and contingency of vision. Is that there's no one portrait here, right? This is multiples, almost cinematically unfolding in time, and this is a series of self-portraits of Albers from 1939 at Black Mountain College, to see this sort of sense of form moving and just never being stable. You know, there's never sort of one final thing, no masterpiece, no final definitive portrait, but it's a kind of ability to see the world through a procedure that unfolds in time. I couldn't resist throwing this in. This is sort of pseudo-morphology, but this is a study from interaction of color and a Donald Judd stack. You know, back to the sort of like, you know, these legacies of Albers and these reconsiderations. You know, I do think there's a lot we could say, obviously, about the influence of Albers and that was said at the time in terms of minimal painting and sculpture. So the legacy of Albers today is a very broad topic in which we could say there's a great deal of geometric abstraction happening in contemporary painting, and that would be you know, the sort of obvious way to think about these threads of Albers's, or you know, and it's not just Albers, and we can think of, you know, many different geometric abstractions from the period that created a very rich discursive field around their work that artists today reflect on. So it's not just the practice of painting, but the sort of talking about the practice that becomes important. You could say Malevich and Mondrian also wrote a lot and taught in various, you know, ways, or used their writings as a kind of pedagogy to, you know, to really sort of teach people how to see abstraction as, let's say, not merely a decorative process, but something that involves this attenuation of vision. And so, you know, there's a lot of different work I'm just showing you, and some of these works, we could say this, you know, is just as interested in Moholy-Nagy as in Albers, but some of these artists who very specifically tie their work to Albers, and here's just some other contemporary practices. I kind of think of the range of geometric abstraction today, but in many of these cases, you know, this is a very strong connection artists make to a figure like Albers. But I wanted to think about, you know, really with the kind of mandate of the show, to think about Josef Albers in Mexico, to take a different tact on that, and to really, you know, sort of say, okay, well, what's another legacy of Albers's in Mexico? And that's something that when I was talking to Jill Magid about her work, she did a project in 2014 called Homage, in which she became interested in Albers's work, and for various reasons related to the lack of access to the Luis Barragán archives in that where Luis Barragán's architect that was based in Mexico City and his archives ended up being sold to Vitra and housed in Switzerland, not accessible to the public. So in the process of researching that project, she discovered that Barragán had a fake Albers in his house, although they were friends. This seemed like a strange thing. This is a Barragán visiting Albers in New Haven in 1967, and this is the one of the fake Alberses in question. It seems to me there might actually have been three, because this is not the same work there, actually. So this, to Jill, sort of, to unfolded a series of questions around, you know, not just artistic friendships and the kind of strange exception that Albers made to say that Barragán could have these fakes, but to kind of open up what the originality in the practice was, and if we're talking about a practice of almost monumental repetition. I mean, you think of the Homage to the Square, you know, there were something like 2,500 Homage to the Squares that Albers produced in his lifetime. And, you know, although this, as I've said, this procedures of thinking about variation, you know, that's still a lot of repetition in terms of painting as this thing that you do motivated on the strengths of the previous study, you know, that procedure still has to kind of like go to the point of, you know, entering the thousands. That's a lot, you know, of careful testing of variation. And to not, for Barragán to have completely disregarded that by, you know, by having a, apparently their cloth prints, not paintings at all, that I don't know if this is the apocryphal story, but that Barragán had bought at a flea market in Texas. So this was not the only kind of point of copy that Magid had discovered. There was an interesting sort of backstory to the butaca chair that Clara Porcet, a Cuban designer, who I'm just showing you one of her other chairs associated with tropical modernism, who actually had been a student of the Alberses at Black Mountain College in 1934, had been working through variations of this Mexican chair, the butaca, which then Barragán copied, and you can see here some of the Barragán, and then Albers copied. And here's some of these butacas at Black Mountain College. So this sort of chain of taking something as a motif, sort of without, as though it's without a kind of history, even perhaps not crediting Clara Porcet's sort of work with it, but also, you know, it's a traditional form, so is there any original at all? And I don't have a shot of the restoration hardware fake Alberses that that Magid had mentioned to me, and which was another motivating factor for her project, was to think, why, what happens to this when it becomes a merely sort of decorative or design element? But I did find these painted pseudo Alberses from an apartment renovation in Paris. So yeah, sort of treating the Albers as though it's something that can just be decontextualized from painting and become like a wall mural that's a kind of riff on an Albers, or sort of associates with Albers without actually sort of participating in that sort of work of, in his case, treating paint as a ready-made and being very careful with how these paints worked together or not. And so Magid began to, and this is a piece in which she began to sort of, you know, think about these various stages unfolding, you know, of the copy. And she did her own copy of the butaca based on the Albers chair. Here's tracing of it. And then here in her show, Homage, you can see the chair. The chair is his copy. But she also, and this I think is what pushes us into an interesting place around this kind of sensibility, I guess you could say, of using the recipe as something that allows us to motivate the next work. She returned to the backs of the Alberses and took seriously this idea that these were something that someone else could do, not just Albers, right? That he's giving you instructions to how to make his work. in a very, very specific way, even to the level of how the varnish would be applied. And so looking at these, you know, these the colors from the paint manufacturers, Magid began to realize that these were no longer available or that paints had changed over time. And because of the, you know, he didn't mix colors, it was very important that it be that thing from the tube. And so these are some of Magid's notes in which she's trying to replicate, based on those recipes, the works. Also the careful construction. You know, I showed you one of the, you know, graph sketches for the variants. Here's Magid trying to sort of work out the schema of how the various Homage to the squares work in terms of, you know, their concentric squares, seemingly embedded but yet abutting. How does that work in terms of very precise measurements? And so she produced her own Homage to the squares based on those instructions. But as I mentioned, it's very difficult to come up with the same thing if these have all changed or certain manufacturers went out of business, so trying to create alternatives. So it becomes a kind of failure of the copy to, you know, be, you know, very close to the original, but in a sort of intentional way. Albers did not intend those back of the painting recipes to be something to make one exactly like that, but to use each of those variables as something that stands in for a potential swap out for something else that would then create a different visual effect in terms of transparency and overlap or dimensionality. So here's some more of the Magid copies. And then another element of the project was to embed these paintings in the book, which, if you can think of a book as like a set of authorized copies, right? You know, reproduction in a book is trying to copy something, but it's okay to do it that way, but it's generally not okay to like make your own Alberses, you know, and show them. So to sort of think about these different ways in which we sort of understand originality and the copy, and we excuse certain ones, as perhaps Albers excused his friendship with Barragán is okay to have those copies. You know, just interesting with Albers's work, the interaction of color manual, which exists as a short manual with 10 silkscreen images, was a larger folio. And all of those were silkscreen because, of course, if you're thinking about the Albers method, he didn't like the way that the mixing of the four color processing would create a mutability of the color that wasn't actually that particular paint. So silkscreen is actually paint on paper as opposed to mixed colors. So this kind of, you know, when you look at the interaction of color, you're looking at the true paint. And you know, and so this is something that when we look at a book of Albers's, we hardly are ever getting that experience of looking at those paints in silkscreen. We're looking at these mixes that kind of, you know, in certain ways, they sort of, you know, alter, I guess, the perception that we would have of the works. So in a way, what Magid is presenting here is a more authentic book illustration, because it's been painted, than the ones that involve the mixing of colors. And I just want to end with one final idea about this kind of the legacy of Albers as procedures as opposed to appearances of things looking like geometric abstraction, but these processes of testing variation as being the important element of what the Albers process is. And this is just some kind of screen grabs from the Interaction of Color app that came out in 2014 that Yale put out. Yale was the original publisher of the Interaction of Color folio. And it seems like, I mean, when I first heard about this, what a weird thing. I mean, this is so against this whole not mixing of colors and the art, you know, the values of every device are different, and it's like all full of this kind of mix of pixels. And the RGB, you know, is always creating these like tension. A screen itself is, you know, illuminated. It has a very different, you know, we have a different effect of vision when we're looking at something that, you know, is vibrant in that way. And in many ways, the Interaction of Color app tried to sort of lock that down by making it a proprietary to the Apple iOS iPad, so that they would very carefully control all those variables, so that it's like when you're looking at the Interaction of Color app, you're not looking at it on, you know, like a Kindle that would have a different, you know, set of values. But I do feel like there's something to be said for sort of like jailbreaking this this kind of problem of like the lockdown, you know, and not just, you know, not to be just critical of the you know, this app, but to think about the potential of geometric abstraction, as Albers argued it, to be this, again, this unfolding of the world with, you know, all of these different values sort of recontextualized, and to think about, you know, really if everything in the world has form, the creative rearticulation of it is the responsibility of us as viewers and as artists. And so, you know, perhaps not accepting, you know, those codes, let's say, of, you know, what things look like in this particular, you know, like, I don't know, like app or whatever, but to sort of open that up to a wider consideration. So I'll just end there so we have some time for questions. And thank you for listening.
I'd like to propose a possible masterpiece of Albers. I think it would fit with your scheme of no masterpiece, because it would be Formulation Articulation, which is a book with I think 217 silk screens, which span his career from the Bauhaus to Yale. So a very decentering masterpiece. Mm-hmm.
Like a boîte en valise, right? The boîte en valise for,
yes, exactly.
Yeah, a little compendium. Yeah, no, that's a great set of work that really highlights, it's like the greatest hits, I guess, but, you know, yeah. And actually, I just wanted to say Jill Magid is here today, so sorry when I was saying Jill, being so casual, she's here, so thanks for coming, and thanks for your work.
Oh, where do you get the app?
It's the Yale University Press put it out. So I don't know if what the upgrades have been. It came out in 2014 to some fanfare, but I'm not sure actually if it's still only an Apple iPad.
I would like you to say something else about the, you know, you showed the picture of Albers and everybody, all the students doing the, well, really that I felt. Maybe you could talk about why they were doing that, because it was about coming from the Bauhaus, mm-hmm. and the body understanding, yeah. the rhythm and the movement, and that's why they were doing that.
Yeah.
And it just maybe we got the impression that it was
a
different impression.
Right,
so
right.
That's...
Yeah, no, I mean, it's certainly about training the body to be sort of accurate as a form in the architectonics of space, which was really the sort of Oscar Schlemmer, who was the theater master of the Bauhaus, and him and Janti Shevinsky, who came to Black Mountain College teaching Bauhaus-derived theater, there was a great deal of emphasis on a sort of precise relationship of the body to thinking about vectoring space, but also defamiliarizing the body so that it wasn't just like the virtuosity of the form, you know, that we would say, let's say in like classical ballet, a certain kind of vectoring of space has this these sort of ticks of beauty or elegance that we associate with the way the body carves space. In Bauhaus theater, there was often this kind of defamiliarization of the body so that how it used space would shock, sort of get us out of those habits of thinking virtuosity of performance. But I think there was also a great deal of training to make that sense of the body in space accurate. You know, it wasn't just defamiliarizing and sort of unloading this or like having this kind of chaos of the body. It was very carefully organizing space and vision. So Walter Gropius designed a theater at the Bauhaus that that would allow for various kinds of movement of the theater to defamiliarize the sort of typical proscenium perspective, and that the theater would possibly turn into like a theater of the round during a performance, and that you would be able to see the bodies differently. So I think, as you mentioned, what you're seeing here is like a very specific kind of training of the arm and eye relationship, so that when the student is emulating Albers, they're doing this in a very precise way, but one that also is about thinking, I think, in these larger senses about like how the way that an artist's hand moves is just another kind of precision of the body. It's technique. And the rehearsal that Albers's process encourages us as makers to do is this kind of training of the hand and the eye to see the world differently, which seems sort of paradoxical, because rehearsal, you know, is a kind of repetitive process of doing the same thing until you do it better than the next time. And that, you know, was a real source of dissension at Black Mountain College, just to kind of go around another sort of trajectory of experimentation in which a figure like John Cage, when he comes to Black Mountain, has a great deal of conflict with Albers around the use of chance in experimental process. Cage said that an experiment is a situation where an outcome is unknown, and Josef Albers found that to be giving too much up to chance. And so this kind of sense of learning and rehearsal was really important to him. But thanks, that's a great question.